we're going to start with a prelude, and everyone, good morning, and you all get to join in if you follow along. It's hymn number 22, God of the Sparrow.
God of the sparrow, God of the whale, God of the swirling stars, how does the creature say awe? How does the creature say praise? God of the hungry, God of the sick, God of the prodigal, God of the creature say care? How does the creature say life? God of the ages, God near at hand, God of the loving heart, how do your children say joy? How do your children say home?
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome everyone, whether you're here in the hall or whether you're on Zoom. We're glad that you're here. I think that you find this place a wonderful collection of people, people who are in a life journey that takes all forms, and we are glad to have all people here. As we love to say, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here, and you are indeed. Our prayer families this week are Eileen Sujata and Betsy and Mike Sullivan. Prayer churches are Christian Cathedral, which is kind of an interesting thought for a UCC church in Sacramento, and Waypoint First Presbyterian Church in San Mateo. Are there any other announcements that need to be made that are not included in your bulletin? Donald.
So, as many of you know, I am involved with the Oakland Interfaith Gospel Choir, and we are already selling tickets for our annual Christmas concert at the Paramount Theater, December 7th, I think. And so tickets are already like on sale, starting at $15 and going up. So if you go to www.oigc.org, get your tickets. And I think every choir member of every like choir within our organization has an assignment of making sure we get at least 10 people to get a ticket. So that's part of the reason why I'm making the announcement. But another reason is, overall, I just want you guys to see the work that we do and just come out, and you will enjoy it, I promise you.
All right.
Thank you. I just brought a few extras with me of postcards for swing states. So if you have not yet had a chance to get a little pack of 25 of them along with 25 names and addresses, and you really would like to write an encouraging, hey, go out and vote postcard to someone in North Carolina, you let me know, and I'll get you all set up. And thank you to those of you who have already taken on this job. And I did put a thank you note in the newsletter, and if I left anybody out, you yell at me and let me know, and I'll fix it.
Thank you. Any others? Okay. Our birthday celebrants this week are Charles Miller, who is Michael's dad, on September 29th. He will be 94. Dale Grothman and Malachi, who's Michael's grandson, on September 30th. And even though he's not really associated with our church, but because he's celebrating his 100th birthday on October 1st, James Earl Carter, and the Reverend Gail Doring on October 4th. And no anniversaries, huh? So.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, everybody. Happy birthday to you.
And may
Yay, Clarice!
How can you not have a good birthday after that? As you know, this is Suicide Awareness Month, and we're almost finished with the month. As we've been sharing the last few weeks about suicide, we know that more than 48,100 people die by suicide each year in the United States. It is the 11th leading cause of death overall. And I wonder how it is among young people. Yeah. I'm sure it's a higher percentage. Yeah. Yeah. It is complicated and tragic, but may be preventable. The more we know, the better we are able to recognize indicators. And everyone can play a role to save lives, share science, share hope, and visit the website that's listed below for many other ways to help raise awareness. And most of all, remember the Suicide and Crisis Lifeline number, which is?
988.
Thank you.
So we're going to all of us join in together in our land acknowledgement. We'll read it aloud. We share this land acknowledgement, our formal statement and public recognition of the indigenous peoples in this country who have been dispossessed. We acknowledge that all of today's structures are built on indigenous peoples' ancestral homelands. This is not about placing blame. It is the first step toward building a more inclusive future where we eliminate the ongoing erasure of indigenous peoples' voices, lives, and history. Our statement provides an opportunity to see the path for learning and for respect to blossom and grow. Amen.
Good morning, all. Well, my ancestor story isn't about someone who influenced my faith, but it is about my grandfather and regret, appreciation, and awe. My father's father, Grandpa Bert, immigrated from England as a young teenager with his mother and his sister. He would have had fascinating stories to tell about his early life. My regret is that I never asked him about his experiences, and he never talked to us kids about them. My appreciation, however, is that my Grandpa Bert wrote his story down. I wasn't aware of this until long after he died and I was an adult, and it's a wonderful legacy. I now know a lot about his life from 1904, when he arrived in Boston, to 1953. In 1918, as my grandfather relates, Uncle Sam called me into the service with a congratulatory letter telling me I had been picked among the chosen few to fight for my country. This, of course, was during World War I, and my dear grandfather kept a journal of his 13 months as an infantryman, including his time in France and Belgium, and being on the front line in the Battle of the Argonne Forest. That 47-day battle turned the tide and caused the Germans to capitulate and ended with the signing of the armistice on November 11, 1918. My short, 130-pound English grandfather wrote about the long marches with the heavy packs, sleeping in chicken houses and on railroad tracks, lice, dysentery, gas masks, unrelenting rain in the trenches, unable to take his boots off for 9 days, and seeing his fellow soldiers getting hit and dying. But now for the awe part. Grandpa Bert survived the war, came home to Sacramento, returned to his old job at a nursery and a florist shop. He met my grandmother, married, and had two great kids. And in 1924, he opened his own florist shop, which he owned for over 30 years. After living through the horrors of war, he came home and was a loving and fun-loving husband, father, and grandfather, a generous, patient, and kind florist who we all loved to be around. I know that many come home from active duty and they're not so lucky. I am just awed that a man can survive what he experienced and be the wonderful grandfather that Grandpa Burt was. And now, today, we give honor, reverence, respect, and recognition to our ancestors upon whose shoulders we stand, and to our elders in whose shadows we walk. We pour libation to honor the past so that we may learn from it. We use water because water has no enemies.
We use water to freshen the road our ancestors traveled, and as a symbol of the continuity of life, to purify and to nourish our souls. Let us say Ashe.
Ashe.
That was good. We could just rotate the mic. That was good. I'm here to do the global and peace witness special offering. In Pennsylvania Church Offering Community, a fresh start. The local laundromat was Linda's chapel. It was where she first shared a prayer concern that had been weighed heavily on her mind and her family's heart, to say nothing of their budget. At the time, Linda was dealing with stage 4 cancer. She confessed to the pastor and the volunteers for the Presbytery Church of Waynesboro, Pennsylvania, who were gathering around Linda and her daughter. "Since I got sick, my washer and dryer can't handle the volume of blankets and bedding." The cost of doing laundry was driving Linda's family and other families deeper into poverty. And so began the church's fresh start. Loads of love. Laundry outreach, let me say that again because this is small print. I'm wearing glasses and I'm really struggling here. I read this ahead of time so I'd know what I'm talking about, but I'm not. Fresh Start, Loads of Love is a laundry outreach program funded in part by a grant received by the Presbytery of Charles. I don't know the place, portion of the Peace and Global Witness Offering. The Presbytery grant empower congregations and individuals to become peacemakers in their own community and in the world. Traditionally received on World Communion Sunday, the Peace and Global Witness Offering is unique in that half of it is directed to peacemaking and global witness efforts at the national church level to address critical justice issues around the world. 25% is retained by the Congregation for Peace and Reconciliation work. Another 25% is kept by mid councils for similar ministries in the regional level. Waynesboro Church's Laundry Outreach Program exemplified the Presbytery Church of USA long-standing commitment to the peacemaking, said Reverend Wilson Kennedy of the PCUSA Associate Directors of Special Offerings and Appeals. Even the simplest tasks, like washing clothes for those on the margin of our communities, help sow seed of peace like Jesus commands us. The following Jesus commandments is integral to the mission of Fresh Start. Reverend Caroline Victory says, let me do it this way. We know that Jesus makes it clear that now we treat the vulnerable with how we treat Jesus. Most of our members are colleague educated, literal middle class. Our laundry outreach has put them in touch with the world whose hardships they're unaware of. It comes as a shock for people to realize how costly doing your laundry can be, and to know that people can't use their SNAP benefits to buy detergent, cleaning supplies, or personal hygiene items. Not being able to keep yourself clean robs people of their dignity. There's something restorative about knowing that people will be able to be their best selves. That's why we call it Fresh Start. It's a chance to start over. There are many other small churches who want to improve the lives of people in their communities so the love of God can be made visible through their ministries, Victory says. By giving to the Peace and Global Witness Offering, people can help other small churches make God's love real and in their town and around the world. And as we always say, when we all do a little, it adds up to a lot. Checks should be made payable to the Community Presbyterian Church with the PGW in the comment line. Special envelopes are available in the back, and they look like that. All right, let us pray. God of peace, even the simplest acts of love and care for others are counted as peace to you. Thank you for showing us the way of peace in the person of Jesus, and walk with us as we work to sow seeds of peace in our world through our gifts. In your many names we pray. Amen.
Can all stand up?
For the beauty of the earth, for the glory of the skies, for the love which from our birth over and around us lies. Christ our Lord, to you we raise this our hymn of grateful praise.
And now for our call to worship. God calls his people together.
Our new life in Christ is celebrated and nourished.
In the fellowship of congregations where God's name is praised, God's way taught.
Where sins are confessed, prayers and gifts are offered, and sacraments are celebrated.
Come, let us worship the Lord.
We come with praise and thanks. We go. Okay, here we go.
You dwell in the shelter of the Lord, right in this shadow for life. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock in whom trust, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under his wings, your refuge, his faithfulness, your shield, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. You need not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies night by day.
Though thousands fall about you, near you shall not come,
and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. For to his angels is given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against the stone. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand.
Pastor Will always said that it's
Daddy Lions. Let us pray together.
Oh, I'll tell you later.
God of grace,
we so often feel overwhelmed and underprepared, not quite able to handle what life has laid before us. We have worries and troubles, doubts and fears, and in the midst of it all, we have not put our trust in you. Sometimes we have actively, stubbornly chosen to go it alone. Other times, we are just too fearful of trusting in you, or too lazy to make the time to pray. Forgive us, welcome us again into your house and your presence. May we find here your presence, a presence that has never left us. May we worship you with renewed confidence that you are there. Amen.
I was just going to
please
share,
be seated.
I had a little Dandelions moment there. I was on hymn 22 when what we were actually singing was hymn 43. So when Elaine looked at me and said, that's the pickup note, I was still trying to figure out on hymn number 22, where are you? That's what happens when you wake up at 1:30 in the morning and you don't fall back to sleep until 3 o'clock. Anyway, it's all good.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Each week, we light our peace candle along with others around the world who light peace candles with the hope and prayer that this flame of peace will join thousands of others to bring peace throughout the world. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for all creation, in the spirit of all teachings of peace, who inspire the many faith traditions, help me and all the people of the world learn how to replace hate, war, oppression, and division with love and peace and forgiveness freedom, and reconciliation. Help us to embody your love in our relationships with our family and friends, strangers, even our enemies. We commit these sacred tasks, so let it be. Amen. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
Bless the Lord, my soul, and bless God's holy name. Bless the Lord, my soul, who leads me into life. Bless the Lord, my soul, and bless God's holy name. Bless the Lord, my soul, who leads me into life.
Now is our time for sharing our prayers of concern or joy, or both. And we'll start, as we always do, with our Zoom participants.
Our Zoom participants this morning are Chuck Dibdahl, Rose Solarzano, and Alan Grissette. So do any of you at home have a prayer request? If so, please unmute yourself and share your concern. Alan?
Greetings, Alan? From the church at home.
Can you say something?
Yeah.
Okay, greetings from the church at home.
That's it.
Okay, thank you, Alan. And Chuck, are you're unmuted, but I guess not. Okay.
Any prayer concerns here? Oh, Betty.
I'm very happy to be back here. A while back, I went to my cancer doctor. I went 12, 13 years, had no problems with it. This was but anyway, he tells me, I got the, what's the name of that stuff? The multiple myeloma for a change. I had to take all these pills day in, day out. And it gets pretty bad. And of course, I didn't get up and go anywhere either. So, but every day it's getting better. I'm happy to be here and see all my friends. Thank you.
Other prayers?
You've been praying for my ear, and I found out I need surgery on it, and it's major surgery. So
So I see the surgeon this week. Prayers that we set a date soon so that I can quit worrying about it.
Lord, in your mercy.
We just returned from, we were at the family beach house, but then we went all the way down south, and I had my first CT scan where they replaced the aorta with a graft right here, 3 to 4 inches of it, and the CT scan showed there's no leaks, and it's perfect, and I have a lifetime warranty for it.
Lord, in our joys.
Good morning, family. I just want to say that it's so wonderful to actually be here in the room with you face to face instead of on Zoom, even though I'm grateful for Zoom now.
Lord, in our joys.
As with the singing bowl this morning, I was hoping that the tones of that singing bowl would reach the people in Israel, in Lebanon, Ukraine, other hot spots around the country, around the world, as well as those suffering from the floods. So.
Lord, in your mercy.
Ben and I have prayers of joy because Ben's son Michael is in Florida. And it just skidded right by them, just a few trees, went down, and then came up to Tennessee, where my son Robert is, and it missed them. They were just west of it. So thank you, Lord, for hearing my prayers.
Lord, have mercy.
Prayers of gratitude. Most of you know we have twins, and both of them deserted us. One's in Pennsylvania, one's in Oregon. But gratitude that we were able to see both of them recently. We went to Philadelphia, saw our daughter, husband, and our new grandson, Emmett, which was great. We returned from there and then flew to Portland and saw our son, Daniel. So we're glad to see them both soon, even though they're far apart. So thank you.
Lord, in your mercy.
Okay. So as many of you know, Chris, my friend, thank you guys for praying for him. His sentencing has been pushed back to October 29th. And so just pray that all will go well. And when things do happen, pray for him, because I think each of us are having a hard time with it, you know, in our own way. And also pray for Chris, because, well, it's a joy and a concern because he was in a car accident this past week. I mean, the side front part of his car is pretty bad, but he made it out without a scratch, thank goodness. And I also ask for prayers for my life. You know, there's definitely a little bit of a change, and little spurts of it are popping up. So I just pray that it will be good. And I'm taking action to do kind of an overhaul of my own life. And also a joy, because my sister informed me that it's gonna be either November or December that her and my brother-in-law are going to see Hamilton, and they invited me to tag along. And I bought tickets for Hamilton a while back, pre-pandemic, and then the pandemic happened and then it got canceled. It was just such a bummer. So I pray that will happen.
Yeah. Lord, in our hopes and in our joys. I have a couple of prayers. I want to read double Tom's prayer for peace in the Middle East. And for friends and associates of mine, Helene was not kind. Montreat, which is a very beloved conference center for me, was pretty much wrecked. Fortunately, Assembly Inn was okay, where most of the action takes place. But Lake Susan, which is usually barely bigger than a cow pond, became an actual lake and overran the dam that holds the water in and went on down Flat Creek and damaged a lot of houses. Astrid showed me a picture of Chimney Rock yesterday, where a picture the day before, or a couple of weeks before, you see a nice stretch of highway with some stores. After Helene went through, flat. So a lot of people are affected in by Helene, and I want to help our prayers. A lot of people are without electricity still, and as we know, that's not always easy to do in this modern age. Also, prayers for my sister. She had her surgery for her knee on Tuesday, and because she is a bargain hunter, she got two for one because they put a wrong part in. So she had a surgery on the next day to replace the part. Fortunately, she's got in good humor about it, and I think everything will be all right, but I appreciate your prayers. Let us pray. Creator God, we give you thanks for the wonder of our world, for the good things that we see in it. Help us to share all those good gifts that you give us. And sometimes the creation can be pretty challenging. And we pray that you support those who have needs in the face of storms, for those who have lost their homes, for those who have lost loved ones. Be with them, comfort them, and grant them your peace. We pray, too, that your peace will overwhelm us and that those who are captured by war and those who are committing violence will finally let go of it so that peace may abound and that all your people may know one another as siblings. We pray, too, for those who have needs on this day and the days to come. Be with those who are going through surgery, for those who are ill. Grant them healing, grant them strength. Be with those who are mourning, that they may be comforted. Be with those who are leading in lives of uncertainty and loss and feel lost, that they may indeed find your spirit to guide them to your love and grace through Christ. We pray for all those people we hold in the quiet of our hearts as we lift them up to you as we pray together in silence. Gracious God, we thank you for your presence with us, for your call to be in the body of Christ. We ask that you continue to lead us and guide us. Be with Janie as she shares your word and her life journey. Be with all of us as we celebrate together that love that you have for us through Christ. And bind us together, not only in that love, but bind us together in our prayers, and especially the prayer we have been taught. Our Creator, who is in heaven, uphold the holiness of your name. Bring your reign so that your will is done on earth as it is done in heaven. Give the bread we need for today. Forgive us, Lord, the ways we have wronged you, just as we also forgive those who have wronged us. And don't lead us into temptation, but rescue us from the evil one. Amen.
Let us all sing, "Great is thy faithfulness."
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, Creator. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, your compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto thee. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto thee.
Amen. Our first reading this morning is from Genesis 22, verses 1 through 14. It's a rather long passage and one we are familiar with, I'm sure. After these things, God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham, and he said, Here I am. He said, Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering and set out and went to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young men, Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship and then we will come back to you. Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. And the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father Abraham, Father, and he said, Here I am, my son. He said, The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Abraham said, God himself will provide the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. And the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here I am. He said, Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, The Lord Will Provide, as it is said to this day. On the mount of the Lord, it shall be provided.
Our second reading is from Matthew 6, verses 24 through 34. No one can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon, in all his glory, was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who seek all these things, and indeed your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and the righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today. This is a word of God.
Thanks be to God.
All creation is a word of God.
All creation speaks volumes of God.
I know I'm among friends, which helps. The theme of my testimony is God's provision in my faith journey. In light of the radical situation wherein Abraham found himself, God's intervention and provision was amazing. He gave Abraham a ram to sacrifice instead of his son Isaac. The story is about Abraham, but I'm sure Isaac was relieved to see the ram. In Matthew, Jesus says we are not to worry over everyday life. God knows what we need and provides it to us. My story begins when I was 5 or 6 years old. My parents started taking their family of 5 children to an Assembly of God church. We attended Sunday school, Sunday morning worship, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. We also attended the nightly services of revival meetings held once a year. I loved church, and particularly loved my first grade Sunday school teacher, Lucille, who took an interest in me. She often asked me to sit beside her in church. It was a delight when she gave me a stick of gum, but it was with the promise I would wait until after church to chew it. My family was poor, and we didn't get treats very often, so I was delighted to oblige. When I was older, Lucille invited me to spend the night with her. She was an elementary school teacher and loved children, but had none of her own. We remained friends until she died at age 95. All of her life, I looked up to Lucille. She loved God and lived her life accordingly. I mention Lucille because I was safe with her. Church was also a haven for me and also for my parents and siblings. My parents couldn't fight there or abuse their 5 children. At that point in my life, I was too young to ask why there was a dichotomy between home, life, and church. Were there good times at home? Yes. But we walked on eggshells, wondering when the next blow-up would occur. I believe God provided me with Lucille and church, like God provided a ram for Abraham. At the beginning of third grade, we moved from Parsons, Kansas to a house 10 miles from Pueblo, Colorado. There was no running water in the house. My parents drew water from a cistern by the bucketful for bathing and doing dishes. Needless to say, we had an outdoor toilet. We once again attended an Assembly of God church, which worshiped Pentecostal style. The church was bigger. It had an attendance of 350 people with strong youth programs. I loved the music and made friends with children my age. When I entered junior high school, or middle school as it is called now, my parents insisted that my older sister, younger sister, and I form a trio to sing gospel songs. We resisted to no avail. It turned out to be a highlight of my life. We practiced as much as possible, arranged our own music, and my older sister Linda taught herself to play the ukulele. She sang as well as accompanying us. We advanced far enough to sing in the worship services, won the talent show competition at youth camp, and eventually we gave 20 to 30 minutes programs at various churches. I loved it. Time passed, and we recorded our music on the old-fashioned cassette tapes. Not too long ago, my son Todd took those tapes and with software took out the static of the tapes. He made a CD for all of us. It brought back beautiful memories. On the CD is a solo sung by my now deceased brother. What a treasure to hear his voice and think again how God provides. Missionaries from Africa, Mexico, and South America visited our church and made pleas to particularly young people to answer the call to missions. I took this seriously and eventually believed God called me to serve as a missionary. I wanted to go to Bible college and filled out an application to attend a college in Missouri. However, when I reached the part about paying for my degree, I was lost. I realized I couldn't pay, and neither could my parents. I knew nothing about student loans. Jim and I married when I was 19 and he was 21. Before we were married, we talked about missionary service. As a teen, Jim felt a call to missions too, but he was required to pastor a church first. After Jim completed his degree in engineering, he attended an Assembly of God Bible College. During this time, he worked part-time and I worked full-time. After Bible college, Jim was called to be the pastor of a small church in Gunnison, Colorado. Before our son Todd was born, we were counselors at a youth camp. I was praying one night about being a missionary. I asked God where to serve. I received a specific impression that it was to be Israel. I was shocked. The only Israel I really knew was what the Old Testament revealed. And why not Africa or someplace else? I decided if it was a true call, God would have to tell Jim. I told him about my call, but I refused to tell him where it was. I knew I put God and Jim on the spot, but I didn't care. I had to know I wasn't imagining things. Well, God provided, and he told Jim the same thing. Jim was ordained, and 2 years later, we were approved by the Assemblies of God Missions Department to go to Israel. After raising money to go and enough to sustain us while we were gone, we took three-year-old Todd to Jerusalem, Israel. We were on student visas. We studied modern Hebrew and Jewish history at the school for overseas students at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. We became proficient enough to read, write, and speak modern Hebrew. At first, we were like 2 to 3 year olds in our quest. We were encouraged to use our Hebrew, even though it was rudimentary. And I'll say there that we intended to be career missionaries there, so we really felt we needed to learn. I went to the post office one day and said, "Give me stamps." Well, that's all I knew to say. The postmaster asked me a question, and I had no idea what he said. A person in line saved me. He asked me in English what I wanted, and then translated in Hebrew to the postal worker. I was so embarrassed. Our time in Israel was challenging. It was a new culture, a new language, and a new way of worship. We attended the Messianic Jewish worship services. They didn't want us there. They thought we would tell them what to do and how to do it. That had been their experience with other missions. However, we didn't do what they expected. While there, we discovered that a Messianic Jew from the congregation had stolen property from the Assemblies of God in the States. Jim hired a lawyer, attended university, and ran a bookstore that had Bibles in 40 languages. He started having chest pains. I said we needed to go home. He didn't listen, but that pain went away after we returned to the States sometime later. We soldiered on until after 3 years we returned to the States, thinking that after a year of raising more money, we would return to Israel. However, I was greatly depressed. Our missionary experience was vastly different from what we experienced in Gunnison. I thoroughly enjoyed being a pastor's wife and had expected missionary work to be the same. Unfortunately, my depression grew worse when we returned, and I sought the counsel of a therapist. After discussing for a time our life in Israel, I started having intense night terrors. My therapy sessions turned to my life growing up. And you know, abuse, if not dealt with right away, returns to haunt you. I went through 7 years of this before I finally met the right person to help me. The terrors went away. God once again provided. During this time, I worked at Hewlett-Packard in Colorado Springs. Jim had returned to engineering after we decided not to return to Israel. We changed churches a year after we returned from Israel. Having known a godly Presbyterian minister in Gunnison, we joined a Presbyterian church and haven't questioned that God wanted us to do this. The thing that was a question for both of us was, why did we go to Israel? We'll never know the whole answer, but I believe God provided a partial one. One thing was, we became aware of the beauty of faith in people of other religions, and that was the start of a long journey in our attitudes and beliefs about the faith of others. Another thing is this. Our son Todd was a sophomore in college when we found out he is gay. It was a shock to me and to Jim. Our upbringing in the Assemblies of God taught that the LGBTQ plus community are immoral sinners and would go to hell. How were we to adjust to Todd's life? We did not reject Todd, but we didn't understand. However, through friends and a caring pastor, we realized God loved our son and didn't reject him or others. To this day, we are thankful we left the Assemblies of God because, first of all, Todd is our son and a child of God. The LGBTQ plus community are humans and worthy of acceptance and love from God and others. In 2021, I published the novel I wrote. The writing of this book took a number of years, probably because I'm a rather slow writer, and I started over from the beginning at least 3 times. I was honored when Pastor Will and Pastor Christy used my book for Tuesday morning book study. They also took themes from it and preached a series of sermons on them. Besides some sales of the book, God provided a beautiful outlet of the story I wrote. Around the time I published my novel, an amazing thing happened. My PTSD night terrors returned after at least a 40-year break.
The diagnosis of professionals was that I again had issues to resolve from my childhood. However, no one could say why at this point in time they occurred. After searching for 4 years, I finally found someone to help me. God provides. I've told you about my life. In it are the provisions I believe God gave me to help me through the rough times and also the opportunity to receive blessings as well. Lucille, church, the Monday Sisters Trio, my brother's song, God's call to missions, friends who stood with me through good times and bad, and professional help. And I'd be remiss if I didn't say my husband Jim has been my rock. I want to say here, I think God gives all of us at least one provision. It is quiet acceptance and peace for the things we cannot change. And we need to recognize, like Abraham did, the rams God provides for us in our daily lives. Amen.
Thank you, Janie, for your beautiful testimony. So much needed.
Watches me.
His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me.
Thank you.
Thank you, Donald, for sharing your gift with us. Each of us is a fragile miracle, evidence of God's creative hands and amazing grace. We are each unique, unrepeatable gifts to the world. We are proof of God's love, and so we who are the gifts of creation now give gifts to our Creator, gifts brought in love.
Most blessed, most glorious, the Ancient of Days, Almighty, victorious, thy great name we praise. Unresting, unhasting, and silent as light, nor wanting, nor wasting, thou rulest in might. Thy justice like mountains high soaring above, the clouds which are fountains of goodness and love. To all life thou givest, to both great and small, in all life thou livest, the true life of all. We blossom and flourish as leaves on the tree, and wither and perish, but not each with thee. Thou reignest in glory, thou dwellest in light, thine angels adore thee, all veiling their sight. All praise we should render, oh help us to see, 'tis only the splendor of light hideth thee. Praise God whose image we all bear. Praise Christ, whose mercy we all share. Praise Spirit, making justice grow. One God from whom all blessings flow.
God's beautiful creation overflows with water, sunlight, and soil to grow our food. When we share the fruits of this earth, there is more than enough for all. There is a table of plenty set by God who loves us. At this table, all are fed, and still there are gifts overflowing into the world God loves. Let us gather our gifts together and offer them to God in gratitude and praise. And let the people of God say, Amen. Amen.
In the bulb there is a flower, in the seed an apple tree, in cocoons a hidden promise, butterflies will soon be free. In the cold and snow and winter, there's a spring that waits to be unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. There's a song in every silence, seeking word and melody. There's a dawn in every darkness, bringing hope to you and me. From the past will come the future, what it holds a mystery. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. In our own there is a beginning, in our time infinity. In our doubt there is believing, in our life eternity. In our death a resurrection, at the last a victory. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see.
Let us together send each other forth with these words. We affirm that we are part of a wonderfully mysterious universe, that all life is interrelated in one vast web, that our role lies in nurturing all life and the planet itself, that every human being is a human family and of equal value, that every human being has the right to the basic necessities of life, that each of us is on an evolving spiritual journey, and that we are called to work to create a world of justice and peace, compassion and respect.
Let's pray. God of the universe, God of our lives, thank you for, like Abraham, the rams you provide in our daily walk with you. Sometimes we feel lost and think you abandoned us. Help us remember your eyes are on us as we journey through life. Amen.